our lovely speaker is going to be Dr. Sheperis. Yeah? Okay. He is the dean at University of Phoenix. He's a professional counselor. He got his degree from University of Florida in counseling, his Ph.D., I'm sorry. And Match.com called him the love doctor. He does frequent interviews with numerous news outlets, such as Huffington Post and the Seattle Times, and he is the author of 4 books. So without any further ado, here's Dr. Sheperis.
There's a slight adjustment to that. Match.com called me a love master. It's a big difference from the doctor to the master, right? Doctor's just, you know, everyday kind of thing. A love master, that's a whole different world, right? It was actually one of the most embarrassing things they did an interview with me on Match.com. You can look it up. And it was Lessons from the Love Masters. And they didn't tell me what the title was going to be when they published the article. And of course, none of my friends will let me live that down ever. But, you know, so I always have to share that as a way of starting a talk on relationships. Because I think it's really funny for me to be a love master because I have struggles with relationships just like everybody else. But I could tell you what's wrong with yours. How about that? That's that's much easier to do. Relationships are hard. Does anybody here think relationships are hard? Yeah, if you're looking around, most of you have your hands up, right? It's tough to be in a relationship. Oh my goodness. You look at it on the news, you see articles, relationships failing all the time, especially if we talk about marriage. You know, how long does a marriage last? You know, how long can you go on and keep a long-term relationship? You know, we see so many relationships end up in divorce, and a lot of times hostile divorce, angry breakups. Anybody ever have an angry breakup? You're not so quick to raise your hands, but you know you did. You know there's resentments in the room from failed relationships. That happens all the time. So one of the things, you know, I've gotten a lot of interviews over the years on is how do we look at relationships? How do we understand if they're going to be successful? How do we know if they're not going to be successful? How do we fix them? And so I've done a lot of talks and done a lot of interviews. I write books on mental health issues. And, you know, I just enjoy talking about this stuff because I think I get as much from talking about it as you do from hearing about it. So it reminds me of all the things I'm supposed to be doing in my relationship when I talk about the issues. Gives you a little prompt so you could act right for at least one day or two. And then see if you can get it right for a week, maybe. So I am Carl Sheperis, and I do work here in the area. I live in Mesa, but I work in Tempe at the University of Phoenix. You probably see our big building over on I-10 when you're driving through there. I work up on the top of that big building, and I'm the dean of the College of Social Sciences. And so that means I run all of our psychology programs, our counseling programs, undergraduate, graduate level. And I run our human services programs and our correctional support service programs. And that is at all of our ground campuses around the country and our online programs. And in case you don't know, we're actually the largest university in the country. So I stay fairly busy. So it is a nice break to come out and actually talk to folks about the things I'm passionate about, about the areas that I like to write about and to do research. And so hopefully by the end of this talk, you will have an idea of how you can look at your partner. Who's in a current relationship? All right. You can look at your partner and say, oh, I'm sorry, we're not going to make it. or you're my forever partner. hopefully you'll get a little predictability out of this, or at least look for some signs. And, you know, if you catch yourself tomorrow saying to your partner, Dr. Sheperis said, you know you're in trouble already. I'm going to leave some time to answer a few questions at the end of this talk, but I do want to go through some elements of this. I'm going to present a couple of things that I think you'll find are funny, and then I'm going to show you the serious side of them, and we'll talk about those too. And so what time do I wrap this up immediately? Oh, I could talk for 4 hours. No, do I have a hard stop time? Okay. That sounds great. All right. So we've got a good amount of time to talk. And so I will try to wrap it up around 8:15 so I could answer questions. Is that right? Okay, super. So one of the things that I figured I'd start with is this image up on the screen and looking at this couple here. And my wife pointed out yesterday when I showed her the slide, I said, "This is look cool." She said, "The woman's winning." I was like, "Well, yeah, I guess." And she's holding the picture. that's part of where we go to right to start. Who wins the argument? We have to figure that out, don't we? Who's the winner? A lot of times in relationships, there's not a winner. You know, there's this phrase, you've probably heard it, you could be right or you could be happy. There's a lot of truth to that, you know, and so we're going to talk a little bit about that along the way. Let me see here. There we go. So I want you to ask yourself some questions. These are the kind of things that will prompt you to think about your relationships that you have or relationships you've had or future relationships. And I think they're really a start for you to determine where you're at in preparation to having a successful long-term relationship. First question, does your relationship with your significant other have the highest priority among all of your relationships? That's a big question. That's a real thing to think about. Where does this stand for me? You know, if I look at friends, if I look at family, and I look at my significant other, where does that relationship stand in terms of having the highest priority among all the relationships I have? That might answer some questions for you already. We might not even need to talk about it anymore. You might have just answered where your relationship stands. The next question, it may seem simple, but I ask this to every couple that I talk to in therapy. Are you committed to making your relationship work? You'd be surprised. Sometimes people, you know, come in together as a couple to do therapy, and they look at you and they've entered into this agreement to see me to figure out how to solve their problems. And I ask them that simple question, and one says, no, I don't think so. I think I want out. And a lot of times that's permission when you ask the question for someone to have a reality check and see, is that really where they're at? And so this is one of those self questions we have to ask ourselves when we're looking at our relationship. Am I committed to making it work? Now that, of course, doesn't mean that if you have a relationship going on and you're committed, that your partner's also committed. And you could be committed all you want, but if you're not committed together, the chances of the relationship succeeding are not very good. And so it has to be a mutual commitment in that sense. But it's important for you to be able to ask yourself as an individual, is this something that I'm committed to? That really prompts that other part of this. Is your relationship reciprocal? Is there a give and take? If you're giving acts of kindness to your partner, do they do the same for you? Is there an interaction that has a mutual benefit in the relationship? It's easy to tell if that's happening or not, or if the relationship's one-sided. But a lot of times we want to deny that element of it. And we can give, 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 and the other partner's not. And we keep saying to ourselves, well, if we keep giving, they'll just go ahead and they'll get it and they'll start giving too. We know that doesn't always happen. And so that's a real important question. Is it a reciprocal relationship? And another piece that happens in a good relationship, and this happens over time, it doesn't happen when you first start to get to know someone, but have you created in a long-term relationship a shared meaning for your lives? Have you done something that kind of creates a vision of the future that puts you both together and that you're headed in the same direction? It's not just about the give and take of the day-to-day, but is there a shared purpose to how your relationship unfolds? and where you're headed together as partners? That's an important question. The next piece, okay, so let's say you're committed to the relationship and you say, yes, I'm in it for the long haul. That's good. But the next piece is, are you willing to change? You know, that is one of the questions we ask as therapists all the time. How many therapists does it take to change a light bulb? Anybody know? No, well, light bulbs can't change themselves. But the light bulb has to want to change. I like yours too. I think I might steal that and use it later. The light bulb has to change itself. I like that one. So it only takes one therapist to change a light bulb, but the light bulb has to want to change. And so when you look at your relationship interactions and the way that you behave with each other, the question is, when there's patterns that you discover that are not positive, that are not working to create enrichment and fulfillment in your relationship, are you willing to do something different about it? How many of you have ever tried a diet? I try them every day. Every day I make a commitment to my diet. By 9 a.m., I'm making a new commitment. You know, there's stages of change. A lot of you are here in psychology, undergraduate. Have you heard of the trans-theoretical model of change? Anybody? It's by Prochaska, DiClemente, and Norcross. And they talk about it saying there's different stages of change where we have a pre-contemplation stage where we look at things and we say, life is grand, there's nothing wrong. And your partner's going, you are insane, our relationship sucks, right? You're just unaware, you have no idea, right? That's the part where I get the client to come into therapy and they say, well, my wife said to come in and I have no idea why. They're just unaware of there being a problem. That's pre-contemplation. I don't know that anything's wrong. Contemplation is when you say, okay, yeah, there's some struggles here. And let's talk about it from that diet perspective. You say, well, I know I put on a few pounds, but if anybody like me gets the smell of the fresh donut when it's baking it at Dunkin' Donuts, and they're just coming out in the morning, you could go, yeah, I know, I got on the scale, but that donut, it's good, right? And I could afford one more donut before I quit. And yeah, that's the contemplation stage. We haven't made the decision yet. We want to do something different, even though we're aware there might be a problem. Think about that in terms of a relationship where you're struggling and you're having arguments and you're having some difficulties and you're recognizing it and you're saying, yeah, but yeah, it'll kind of adjust itself. It'll work itself out. We don't really have to do something different yet. Preparation is when you're saying, okay, look, I've recognized that I put on a few pounds. I got to take off the weight. And now for me, I'm almost 50 years old. And so my metabolism has changed. It's not so easy to take off the weight like it was when I was in my 20s. And so I've got to put in some preparation and think about what do I have to do different? Than just getting on the diet. I might have to actually do some exercise this time, and I might have to think about some behavioral changes and not eating at night and things like that. Well, when we start talking about relationships, it's not as easy to come up with some solutions as it is to think about a diet. You know, if we think about a diet, you know immediately what to do. Let's stop eating the Dunkin' Donuts. When you're talking about a relationship, it's pretty complex. There's a lot of variables. What do I do to change? I might not know how. So thinking about that, that's where we get people who come into the counselor's office because they're not really sure of what to do next to make the change. And so they come in prepared, but not really sure of how to go about it. When they get to the action stage, that's where we've got a plan, we know what to do, we will go ahead and follow through on it and start making the changes in our daily life. I would love it if clients came into my office in the action stage of change, but they don't. That is so rare. Most often they come in the contemplation stage and think, yeah, there might be something wrong, but I'm not sure I want to do anything about it. And so my job is to get them to help make a decision about what they want to do and to figure out if they want to make some changes. The last stage of the model is the maintenance stage. So once we help somebody make a change, like for me with looking at that diet piece, you know, I often, if I lose a little weight, will slide right back and put the weight back on because I don't practice maintenance. You know, once I lose 5 pounds or 10 pounds, I go, yeah, I could afford to eat that donut again. And all of a sudden it's back on, right? We've slipped right back into it. Same thing happens in relationships. We might go for a little while having made some changes, like in being nice to our partner or picking up around the house or doing these reciprocal parts of you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. And then after a little while, we slip back into our patterns of behavior and we go right back to the arguing and the fighting of where we were before. And so if we don't address the maintenance component, we end up just slipping right back into the patterns of behavior we've had. There's a favorite little short story that I like that really captures this essence of this trans-theoretical model of change, and it's called Autobiography in 5 Short Chapters. And what it says is, I'm walking down a sidewalk, and there's this big hole. And as I'm walking down the sidewalk, I fall in the hole, and I'm scared, and I don't know what to do. I'm lost. I don't know how to get out of here. It's horrible. Eventually, I find my way out. That's chapter one. Chapter two, I'm walking down a sidewalk. There's a hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I'm scared. I'm lonely. Oh my God, I don't know how I got to this hole. Wait. I've been here before. Okay, I remember how to get out of here, so I get out. Chapter three, I'm walking down a sidewalk. There's a hole in the sidewalk. I fall in. I recognize it immediately that I've been in this hole. I get right out of the hole. Chapter four, I'm walking down a sidewalk. There's a hole in the sidewalk. I walk around the hole. Chapter five, I walk down a different sidewalk. It takes a while for us to change our behaviors. Has anybody ever gotten into a relationship? It didn't go well. You ended it. And then you got in a relationship with the same exact person, but they had a different name. You just walk down the sidewalk for the second time, right? That stuff happens, and you know we tend to repeat our patterns of behavior over time. And so understanding how we change is important. And so when I ask, are you willing to work on your or improve your relationship, that's an important question. Are you willing to walk down a different sidewalk? Are you willing to walk around the hole this time? Or are you going to just do the same exact thing you did again and say, it'll be better this time, right? Probably not, but good luck. The other thing, and I know this is hard for some people, it's back in my day we called it PDA, public display of affection. Fondness and admiration for your partner, being able to actually have intimate relationship. And I don't mean intimate by saying sexual, I mean intimate by, do you have the ability to touch each other in a healthy and passionate way that shows intimacy? So that's a kind touch to the hair or to the face. Do you hold hands? Do you show fondness? Do you show affection to your partner? And is it reciprocal? Those are important signs that you are connected in a way to each other. And then finally, as a question, do you turn toward each other as things get tough? When you're finding yourself struggling, are you the kind of folks that separate, walk away, storm out of the room, find a way to go, you know, take care of yourself? Or do you find a way to connect with each other and work toward a solution? Those are some interesting questions to ponder as you're looking at relationships. And, you know, from a counselor, it sounds like pretty decent advice to just look at these things. I didn't come up with them. These are actually science-based. And so we're going to get to talking about the science of these elements and how we understand them from a scientific perspective and help you to understand how important each of these questions really is in predicting the success of your relationship, predicting the failure of your relationship, or doing something different to make sure your relationship is strong. So relationships kind of have styles. They are usually some patterns that we see that we could look at with different couples and be able to tell what kind of relationship you have. So a validating relationship, I think you probably get that word. You understand what that means. We validate each other. We find a way of propping each other up and helping each other move forward. We're encouraging. We find a way of supporting each other, not just in when times are tough, but in reaching each other's goals, in finding a way through daily life. We're interested in each other. We're interested in each other's jobs. We're interested in each other's work. Well, those are the same things. That was a little redundant. We're interested in each other's jobs. We're interested in each other's friendships. We're interested in each other's hobbies and activities. And we find ways to validate each other's process. Volatile relationship. That's another style. Those could be really passionate and interesting. And they are energetic relationships, but they move and fluctuate in terms of the style of interaction over and over. So it could be passionate in terms of anger and passionate in terms of love, all within the same day. And those relationships are hard to predict where they go. And so that relationship has high energy, but it just fluctuates in how it's demonstrated from one day to the next or 1 hour to the next. And then there's the avoidant style of relationship. And that type of relationship is the one that is, I'm a master addiction counselor. In my addictions work, we read the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous. And in that book, there's one phrase where it really captures this avoidant element where there's a tornado they're talking about and somebody comes out of the storm cellar and says, look, Ma, ain't it grand that the wind stopped blowing? You know, there's an avoidant element of talking about what's going on at the moment. And instead of addressing what the problems are in the relationship, you just pretend that there aren't any. And we just keep going on each day. And so that style of relationship is one where things kind of fester underneath the surface and tend to blow up at different moments. So, you know, it's a good question to ask yourself if you've been in relationships, what style of relationship you've had, how that's fit for you in terms of the descriptions I've given, and if there's any differences that you've heard. So let's consider those, and I'm going to go on and I'm going to show you a video in a minute. Some of you might have seen the video. It was one of those viral YouTube things, and it's kind of funny. It's called It's Not About the Nail, and you know, I was thinking about this presentation, and I was thinking about this video and how it kind of captures a lot of the essence of the questions we're going to talk about here. And I'm going to go back to it a couple of times through the rest of this presentation. And as we go through some of the elements of predicting success or failure in relationships, I think this video really captures it in a good way. So give me a permission here to slip out and go to the video itself. I tried to embed it, but it wasn't working in the system. So let's look at this here for a second.
It's just, there's all this pressure, you know? And sometimes it feels like it's right up on me and I can just feel it, like literally feel it in my head, and it's relentless. And I don't know if it's gonna stop. I mean, that's the thing that scares me the most, is that I don't know if it's ever gonna stop.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix things when what I really need is for you to just listen.
No, see, I don't think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail
out... See, you're not even listening now.
Okay, fine. I will listen. Fine.
It's just... Sometimes it's like... There's this achy... I don't know what it is. And I'm not sleeping very well at all. And all my sweaters are snagged. I mean, all of them.
Yeah, That sounds really hard.
It is. Thank you.
Ow!
Oh, come on, if you would just—
Don't!
Try to see things my way. Do I have to keep on talking till I can go on? We can work it out. We can work it out.
It's funny, right? That's funny. It's not about the nail. All right, we're still good here. So that video, a lot happened in a minute and 40 seconds there. And I know we're watching it and we're thinking, you know, oh, typical guy, he's trying to solve the problem. Typical girl, she wants to talk about the problem. We have some stereotypical kind of elements in there. But there were a lot of things that happened in that video that I'm going to go back and highlight that are actually scientific predictors of success or failure in relationships. And whoever directed and wrote this script, when they directed these actors, I don't know if they coached them on some of these microfacial behaviors and some of the elements of interaction, or just let them kind of ad-lib it, but it is right. It's perfect in terms of demonstrating some of the behaviors we want to see when we're looking at how do we predict success or failure. So there's this guy, John Gottman, and you might read about him in your psychology books. He's in Seattle, and he started out as a guy who was kind of interested in mathematical models and research. And he was really interested in how do I figure out the elements of a relationship. And he wanted to figure out how do I fix broken relationships. And his first idea was that if I could figure out what the problems are with a relationship, I can fix it. Over time, he came back and said, that's not true. Just because you know what's broken doesn't mean you can fix it. He had to actually go back and figure out what are the elements that make a relationship successful, so that he can then take those elements and build on them and help people make changes. So just knowing what's wrong doesn't necessarily make things better. But Gottman's an interesting character. He he still is a very involved research scientist. And he has taken the idea of creating a research laboratory that is very specific just to marriage. And understanding relationships. And so even at one point, he created an apartment laboratory where he had people come and stay in the apartment so he could watch and observe them and develop an understanding of what happened in terms of the relationship dynamics over time. And so when he was doing his studies, he started hooking people up to blood pressure monitors, measuring their pulse rates, measuring their sweat glands, measuring all types of physiological response sets. And he also started coding, he developed a coding system for looking at their microfacial behavior movements so he could know what looked like this idea of contempt, for example, which you could see up there. If you could look at that picture of this guy, that kind of looks like contempt, doesn't it? Like he looks like he's not really happy with whoever he's looking at. That he's not, you know, he has some level of disgust about whoever he's looking at. So he went back and he started looking at the relationships, and he would say to a couple, okay, I just want you to talk, you know, talk about anything. And then he'd go back and watch the videos that he recorded of these couples interacting. And he would look at what are these changes in relationship dynamics? What sparked a reaction from somebody? So he would look at things like, did you smile? Did you frown? Did you kind of wrinkle your nose? Did you roll your eyes? Things like that. And he developed this coding system that he can go through and code all the elements of the interactions. So he can see in a video after watching for 30 minutes, what the predominant type of interactions were, if they were positive or negative. And so after watching hundreds of these videos and coding them, he came up with these behaviors that he called the four horsemen of the apocalypse for relationships. Criticism, contempt, defensiveness, and stonewalling. Now, why are they the four horsemen of the apocalypse? That's an important question. Because Gottman was able to study things longitudinally. And if you understand research, what that means is that he took these couples and he looked at them over time and was able to look at these behaviors and then be able to predict whether that relationship would succeed or fail after 10 years. And what he got to in terms of his research was that in 30 minutes of observation of a videotape today, his students can predict with 95% accuracy whether or not your relationship's going to fail within 10 years. That's pretty tough, isn't it? He can do it in 10 without a video just by watching you interact. 10 minutes of just watching you talk at the dinner table at a restaurant, if he's sitting at the next table, he can probably tell whether you're going to be together in 10 years or not. And that is a highly accurate prediction. He's tied in the physiological responses, he's tied in the behavioral coding system, and he's done what he's called differential equation modeling, which is a sophisticated mathematical process that he can use to then take all these elements and predict out relationship success or failure over a 10-year period. That's pretty phenomenal stuff. And what he found as the main primary culprits in relationship failure were these four horsemen of the apocalypse. And so, criticism. When we're looking at our partner and we're talking about, you're a problem, you do this, I don't like it when this happens with you, this is something that's wrong. Let's check it out with the video again. So we'll go back here, and let's go to 45 seconds. All right, do we have sound on the video?
That maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this.
Right there. You always do this. That's one of those criticism elements. Have you ever caught yourself saying that to your partner? Everybody's saying, no, I just said it to mine the other day. We all can be critical in some elements, right? And it's not about the fact that do you do this ever. It's how often do you do it, and is it a primary interaction style in your relationships? Is it something that we see happening over and over again if I'm watching you interact? Right, so we had this little 1 minute and 40 second video, and all of a sudden right there it is. You always do this. So let's go back to the PowerPoint slide again. Contempt. Contempt is... can be very clear. It could be something you say. You could say you disgust me, or you just drive me crazy. Or it could be something as simple that happens that you don't even know that you rolled your eyes when your partner said something. All right? And so, like, Gottman will do that. He'll tape these kind of things, and subsequently we do too in our practice and in our clinics. We'll take a couple and watch them, and then we tape it, and then we could go back and show you the tape, and you don't even know that you did the eye rolling, but I could show it to you and say, here it is right here. You know, this is one of those behaviors that you're not recognizing that's happening that signals to your partner that you're not pleased with them at the moment, and that actually you're feeling a sense of disgust, or you're feeling a general contempt for them. And, you know, so recognizing that behavior in yourself is important. So let's look at it here in the video again, and it's at 32 seconds. We ready for the video?
Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there.
Stop.
Wait, did I miss it?
Trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always...
I'm going to go back here.
Yeah. Well, you do have a nail in your head.
It is not about the nail.
Are you sure? Because, I mean, I'll bet if we got that out of there...
Stop trying to fix it.
No, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm just pointing out that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to...
There it was. I had the wrong... It was 45 seconds, not 32 seconds. Let's watch that again. Watch what happens right at 45.
Now, that maybe the nail is causing...
You always do this. You always try to fix...
He kind of glances to the side. His eyes roll. And it's just this thing that happens. It's brief. It happens in a flash of a second. And we don't even recognize we're doing it. And this is just a little, you know, YouTube video that's acted out, but he does it perfectly. You know, and I don't even know if he recognized that he did it. They might have said, you know, pretend like you're really unhappy with your partner and he's, you know, in this role, and he just does that automatically. And so you see that eye roll. That's one of those things. And again, it's not that you do that. It's how often do you do it, and how much does that play a role in your relationship satisfaction? So let's go back to the PowerPoint again. Defensiveness. That's when, you know, instead of being able to get into a discussion about what's going on, if I bring something up to you in your relationship, in our relationship, and I have something I want to talk about, that you try to turn the tables and make it about me. And that you're saying, wait, hey, you know, and you see this kind of posturing. Right? You know, you notice your hands go up. It's kind of a defensive motion. And we can watch that happening in the interaction between a couple that, you know, we used to say talk to the hand. Well, that didn't come out of nowhere. It's because people have this automatic reaction when they're in a defensive mode that the hands go up. And it's not defending yourself from being attacked. There's actually this posture that says to somebody, back off. And that I'm not interested in resolving this. And so we have this automatic behavior we do that signals to our partner, we're not ready to solve a problem. And so let's look at it in here. And it is at 50 seconds this time. So I'm going to play it from 46.
Things when what I really need is for you to just listen.
See, I don't... I think that is what you need. I think what you need is to get the nail out.
See, you're not even listening now.
Okay.
So, you know, one of them's trying to solve, and he's saying, look, there's obviously a nail in your head. All right? If you just pull the nail out, I think you're going to have a little bit of better solution. Things are going to be better. And instead of addressing what he says, she says, if you would just listen. Right? So there's no acknowledgement of what the partner said. Now, I'm not taking sides. This is just a clip in it because he does the same thing. Right? They do it to each other, a defensive reaction. So we could go through and pick out all the elements of it and make it where he was defensive and then where she was defensive. But that just shows it right away. Instead of having that reciprocal nature of a talk in a relationship where we say, so wait, you're saying I have a nail in my head and you think that it would be better if I just pull that out. That's listening, right? We do that as counselors, and people think it is magic. You know, like, oh my God, you're listening to me. When I say something back to you and you say, you know, it's just, my relationship has been so difficult and my partner just doesn't get me. And I'm like, you're really frustrated because your partner doesn't get you. Nobody's ever said that before. You know, you get me so well. How do you do? And it's because in our life, people don't listen to us. We're always thinking about what our thing is next to say, right? And so we don't feel validated for our feelings, for our emotions, for our thoughts, because I say something and then my partner says, oh yeah, well, this is what happened to me. Or let me tell you what happened in my day. Right? Instead of, let me really validate what I heard you say and listen and see if I understand it. Now, we have this really funky thing in counselor training. It's not just called empathy where we're tapping in and really understanding. It's advanced, accurate empathy where we could get in and actually label the feeling you're having accurately. And then you feel like, ooh, you're a mind reader, right? But really it's not, because I could see that you're really clearly frustrated and you're just like, and I don't know. Wow, you're really frustrated right now. Yes, yes I am. You know, and it's like amazing. But the truth is that the problem is, in real life, we have so many pulls, people pulling us in so many different directions, so many demands, that we don't take the time to really pay attention to those things in our partner and to be able to tap into them and say, hey, I recognize that you're feeling a certain way and I understand it. And when we're connected with our partner and we are actually spending time building our relationship and our shared meaning, we get to know those things about our partner. We get to know what a certain look means in terms of the way they're feeling. We get to know what's happening behind the curtain, and you can label it accurately. The problem is we don't take time to do it even if we know it. And so that is one of those elements that we have to look at. So going back to this again, stonewalling is the last one of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And stonewalling is that part where I'm not going to solve this problem. I'm sorry. There's no fixing it. I'm going to go to my cave as a man, and I just need my alone time, and we're not going to talk about it anymore. I'm guilty of that all the time. That's one of the things I do. Lucky I don't do all four horsemen. But I am, you know, one of those guys that there was a book, Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus, and I didn't really like the book very much. But in the book, there was one thing that I really thought was interesting, is that there's stereotypes of how women like to talk things out to solve problems, and men kind of like to isolate and think about the problems before they're ready to talk. In general, that, you know, that could play out, but people can be very different from that. So you can't look at it as actually very stereotypical. But I, in that sense, when I get too frustrated, I need to back off, and my wife needs to talk about it. Right? Anybody ever have that problem in a relationship? Yeah, I see some hands going up. It's a true thing. And what we can do reciprocally in our relationships is recognize what's happening for our partner and spend time talking about that. I know you really need to talk about this right now, and if we could just talk about it in 15 minutes, let me calm down, I will talk about it with you. If somebody said that to you and you really needed to talk about it, you might feel a little bit better because you know that it's gonna get talked about. Or if you said, hey, I know that I really need to talk about this, but you need to just have a few minutes to breathe before we do. Why don't I just go and get a cup of coffee and come back in 15 minutes and we could chat about it. And you have this reciprocal respect then that recognizes what the other partner needs, and be able to find a way to mutually get each person gets their needs met, and then you can meet your needs as a couple by coming together and talking about it. But stonewalling is that part where I'm not willing to come back to it. I'm not willing to address it with you, and I'm going to just make sure that we don't talk about it, we don't solve the problem. So let's go to stonewalling in the video. Right at a minute 5. We ready for the video? All right, we got thumbs up.
Sometimes it's like there's this achy, I don't know what it is.
Is he really invested in listening to her? That's a form of stonewalling. He says, okay, we can talk about it. All right, I'll listen to you. And she says, what's going on? And he's like, God. He's not really listening to her. He's actually in his head thinking, you're crazy. Right? You know, you've got this nail in your head, and I can't believe, all you gotta do is pull it out. And he's not saying it out loud. He's not sitting there actually trying to understand what feelings she's having and what's going on around with this issue. So what happens again at the end?
Ow!
Come on, if you would just...
If he was really listening, there wouldn't be that, come on, because he wasn't sitting there really trying to authentically figure out what was going on with her emotions. So when we watch this video, it's funny, right? We watch this interaction, we go, oh my God, it's a nail in her head, ha, ha, ha. But if you break it down and you look at the little ways they interact, the things they say to each other, the way they behave in their interactions, those are all parts of what Gottman took 30 years ago and was able to predict marriage success and failure with. We see in this video, right off the bat, criticism. You always do this, you always try to fix it, you never listen. Every time there's something wrong with me, you don't ever pay attention. And he's like, you know, you just don't want to do anything about the issue. The issue is right there, it's right in your forehead, you don't want to manage it. He's critical. She's critical. Contempt. You mostly see the contempt in the video from him. He rolls his eyes about a dozen times in a minute and 40 seconds. If you go back and watch that over and over again, it's just that way that they interact with each other's facial expressions that he has that just show that contempt for people. Now, you know, we use microfacial expressions all the time in psychology. And we can find, if you just do Google searches for contempt, you could pull up hundreds of images that really capture the emotion. But if you just videotape couples that you know and do it for about a 15-minute period and you go back and watch the video, you probably see at least one contempt in that 15-minute interaction. So again, it's not the fact that it happens. It's how often is it happening. The defensiveness, the stonewalling, like I said, they're present in all relationships. It's the fact of how often do they occur. So what that means is that we end up in a cycle of negativity if we have these things occurring too often. And everybody knows what occurs when you have a cycle or a pattern of behavior, especially when it's in terms of relationships. If we have this pattern where we're stonewalling, we're defensive, we're criticizing, then we are going to end up combusting. And so the negative interactions that we're having end up becoming a pattern of behavior that just unfold on each other over and over again, and they become more and more self-reinforcing, and the relationship struggles become more and more intense. So the pattern intensifies over time if it's left unchecked. So this isn't something that if we just let it go, if we've developed these behaviors that are kind of self-destructing of a relationship, if we don't do anything different about them, we can watch them from a psychological perspective. And I could observe you over time as a couple from a therapeutic perspective, do videotape recordings, and I can show you that over time, that pattern will intensify, and that your relationship struggles will grow more and more intense if they're left unchecked, if you don't have a therapeutic intervention, if you don't do something differently. What happens then is the stonewalling. So once those relationship patterns become ingrained and you have intensified them, then you start to isolate and you stop interacting with each other altogether. You might live in the same household, but you're not talking, you're not maybe not sleeping in the same beds, you're not interacting in a healthy manner, you're basically two single people living in the same household. And so that is what happens as a result of letting these things go on forever. So I have now successfully told you what happens to relationships in a negative sense. And now that we feel the gloom and doom, let's talk about lasting relationships. My wife's in the audience. She didn't know I put this picture up there. So I talked about the things that I do wrong, right? I do some things right. Right? I am the love master, by the way. So we just took this picture not too long ago. It was over the... this was over New Year's? Yeah. So this was actually just this past, you know, about 30 days ago. And it was a spontaneous picture. That's what one of the things that I really like about it. It's not one of those pictures that you get where People are posed. If you go to one of the studios and you go to the Sears Portrait Studio and they have you sitting next to each other and they say, look this way, look that way. This was actually one of those things that was just kind of spontaneous and we got the picture taken. And I think it shows, you know, there's a lot in it. You know, there's the smile, there's the eye contact. You see my wife reaching up and touching my face. There's an intimacy in it. Believe it or not, I could, from a therapeutic stance, from an analysis stance, I could have you bring in pictures of your relationship. I don't even need to see the video interactions, and I could tell you a lot by looking at just a couple of pictures. Where do you stand next to your partner? How do you interact in the, you know, now if it's a Sears Portrait Studio picture, that's different. But in spontaneous pictures, you can tell a lot about relationship styles, relationship interactions, closeness, all those kind of things. And so I think you might get the idea here that my wife and I are close. We have a good relationship. But I think it's important to say we don't have a perfect relationship. Nobody does. And that's one of the problems that happens for most people, is that you think there's an ideal relationship, a perfect relationship to be had, and there's not. It's what we make it. It's how you take actions to improve your relationships if you've made the decision you want to be in it. So what can you do? First off, we know by looking at these longitudinal studies and looking at couples over time and interviewing them over and over again, that by talking to couples, one of the things that the couples who stay together for long periods of time consistently say over and over again is that their partner is their best friend. It's important. Lasting relationships are based in friendship. And that's one of the essential ingredients. And unless you're developing that friendship, you could have the most amazing sex in the world, but that's not going to be the long-lasting component that makes it work. It's about the friendship part and how you really enjoy each other's company. Having an intimate knowledge of each other. And caring about the intimate knowledge of each other is an important piece to add to that. So knowing about your growing up years, knowing about your family, knowing about the things that make you happy, knowing about the things that make you sad. I know for my wife that when she is ready for the senior retirement home, that there must be a turning, glimmery disco ball that gets hung above her bed to make her happy. Anything shiny. She loves anything shiny. So we even have it down to the fact of what happens when she no longer is really cognizant of the world, but she's in her room in the retirement home, and then she has her little disco ball. But, you know, that's funny, but it really is true that we have to know all these things of what makes a good gift, what makes somebody happy, what is something that could happen during the day that really sets a bad mood. You know, how do you start the day off right with somebody? It's the little things that matter. And we say that over and over again in our language when we talk to each other, that the little things matter. But in truth, in relationships, that is a key ingredient, is knowing the little things about our partners. Acceptance and respect. Knowing your partner is who they are, accepting them for it, and demonstrating respect in your relationship. Another key ingredient. Now, you're saying, why are these key ingredients? Because as we've interviewed couples over and over and over in relationships that lasted, we do an analysis of the themes that have been part of these couples that are successful. And this was one of the factors that came out, that we accept each other for who we are and that we respect each other. There's also an important element that you have to have a positive perception of the relationship and a positive perception of your partner, that in general, they're a good person, and that I see them as somebody valuable and meaningful in my life, and that you demonstrate that. And then Gottman said you have to create love maps. And I think that is kind of fluffy in terms of a phrasing to say love maps. But what he really means is that you have to create a pathway for you as a couple to come together. And what that means is all the elements before it, understanding what it takes to make things work with your partner and creating an understanding of how to get there in your relationship. So like I said, knowing what, if your partner needs time alone before they talk about something serious, knowing that your partner needs to talk about things and talk it out, and understanding what you have to do to make that work, that's part of a love map. You're creating the pathway to success. So understanding these things about each other and then creating a map on how to get there, having that preparation stage of change and moving forward with it. Demonstrating interest. So it's not just about being interested. You could say all day long that you're interested in your partner, but how do you demonstrate it? How do you show them that you're interested in their interactions and what they like and what hobbies they have and what brings them joy? And so you have to demonstrate that interest. And again, as I said up front when I asked you the questions about your relationship, you have to show affection. And so these are the parts that not just Gottman, but many researchers have looked at over the years. And from a scientific perspective, have developed differential equation models and logistic regression models that can actually predict relationship success if these factors are present. So if I'm watching a videotaped interaction of you, I'm looking at how many of the four horsemen of the apocalypse are present, and I'm looking at how many of these success factors are present. And guess what the essential ingredient is here? You have to have more of the positive elements than you have to have of the negative, right? So when I was telling you earlier that, you know, you could do these things, but it can't be the predominant kind of way you interact, what we know, and we know this very clearly, is that you have to have a 5-to-1 positive behavior ratio to any negative interactions in your relationship. 5-to-1. So you could actually count them. If you ever, like, most of us today have like video cameras in our house and things like that, or you have laptop cameras, things like that. You could set up even like a little house nanny cam and observe yourselves interacting and go back and count your positive to negative interactions as a little experiment. And you have to be able to say, if we're going to be successful and we're going to make it as a couple, that we're having at least 5-to-1 positive to negative interactions over time. Now, I do a lot of child and adolescent work. And so we do something called parent-child interaction therapy. And we do the same kind of coding system in coding parents and children in their interaction style that Gottman did with couples. And so what we'll do is we'll send kids into the clinic, into the playroom with their parents. And I'll say, I want you to play together. There's toys in there. Pick out whatever you like. Let the child pick out whatever they like. You guys just go play. We're going to observe you for 15 minutes, and then we'll let you know when the time's up. That's the only instructions we give. And then we go back and we code those interactions in the playroom, and we look at the behaviors. And I look for things like praise, where the parent's reflecting back what the child's saying and showing that they're listening. I look to see if the child's actually getting, or the parent's actually getting down playing with the child and imitating what they're doing. If they're kind of like interacting and describing what they see the child doing, like I see you're playing with the truck. And if they have any enthusiasm, I'm looking to see if they're excited about playing with their child. On the flip side of that, I look for all the elements that we talk about from the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse, and I look for the negative interaction styles. I look for criticism. I look for disciplinary action, things like that. How many positive interactions do you think I normally see in that 15-minute observation with parents that just kind of come in to talk about working with their children? Any guesses? I see 5, 3. It's between 0 and 1. Most of the interactions are negative. And when I show this to parents later on and I watch the video with them, they're shocked because they think they're highly positive in their interactions. The same goes true for our relationships. We have a lot of negative interactions when we code them and watch them later. So you might have this idea that ain't it grand, the wind stopped blowing. But the truth is that you're having a lot of negative interactions that are going on. And so you have to start to raise awareness of your interaction styles and to really pay attention. Am I having positive to negative? Am I having a greater positive to negative interaction ratio? Now, one of the things you can practice actively is empathy. We can't train you to be an empathic person. If you don't have the capacity for empathy, that is very difficult for us to create within you. And that is one of the things we look at when we train counselors. When people are coming in as graduate students, we look at, do you have this capacity for empathy? Can you demonstrate that you innately care for other people and that you have a way of demonstrating that care? It's very different from sympathy. It's not saying, oh, I feel so sorry for you, but it's connecting in a way that lets somebody know that you that you hear them, that you're connected to them, that you're listening, and that you genuinely care. And so you could practice, if you have that capacity within you, you could practice demonstrating it. It's very simple to, you know, when someone's feeling down, to just put a hand on their shoulder and letting them know that you're there. It's taking those little action steps to demonstrate empathy. This is the biggest thing for most of you. I see most of you in the room are fairly young. When your partner's talking to you, turning off your phone. It's very difficult to demonstrate empathy if you're in the middle of Facebook or in the middle of playing a game on your phone or texting. This is one of the biggest fears I have from a mental health professional, is that our social media, that our technology, that our interactions are decreasing our ability to demonstrate empathy with each other. And so I think practicing that element, that when we're having a conversation with a partner, that we're turning that phone off, that we're taking that time to actually practice demonstrating empathy and connection. And one of the big things is fostering a healthy sexual intimacy. You know, it's okay to be adventurous in your sexual interactions, to have fun, but there also has to be a component of your sexual interaction that is a healthy, intimate connection with your partner. So it's not a judgment point. You know, you could have a variety of interests in your sex life, in different types of sexual behaviors, different types of sexual practices. But in the end, there also has to be a component to it that demonstrates love and connection. And so that's an important piece, that if it's not there and you want to build your relationship in a positive direction, that you actually have to practice that. And you have to institute it as part of your intimate connection. And the last piece is, if you do not have conflict in your marriage or in your relationship, in your long-term relationship, ever, your relationship's going to fail. Because you have to be able to have conflict to know how to navigate conflict. And conflict's going to pop up. And so fostering healthy conflict and healthy conflict resolution is critical. So working on how you come to an agreement over something that is a disagreement, or how you agree to disagree, and coming and practicing and rehearsing that in your everyday interactions for the time when something big comes up. Because in everybody's life, in everybody's relationship, something big comes up. There's no way to get around that. That's life. And if before that time you've never practiced conflict resolution with your partner, that's going to really make a big impact when something big happens. So the science. I've got just a minute or two. I've talked about so far, all of these elements have been demonstrated time and time again through research. And not just research where we went out and surveyed somebody, but research where we measured physiological response sets. Research where we've done EEG studies, where we could see in the brain through fMRIs that there's different elements activated during conflict compared to positive interactions. That we can see what changes in the way the energy connections occur in your brain through EEG analysis when you are demonstrating empathy to someone, and that those connections occur. So what we're trying to do now from a research stance is find ways to build on what's already been done in the relationship world and expand our understanding of patterns of behavior and differential equations that can be used to match those. So like my wife and my wife's also a research scientist, and we actually do research together a lot. We've written books together. One of the research studies we've been doing is working with some engineering professors and measuring interaction styles between therapists and kids with autism. And putting EEG caps on kids with autism. And our hope is that we could develop the same differential equation models that will predict success or failure and behavior change for kids with autism during intensive behavioral intervention. Because that is one of the most difficult issues to treat. The average kid with autism, the treatment costs $2 million per child over their lifetime. And we have to come up with better ways of understanding what is successful and not successful. The average child with autism needs 20 hours a week of therapy. So if you think about those kind of things, it's really important for us to develop ways of understanding the therapeutic relationship with kids with autism and what predicts success or failure there. And for us to be able not just to come up with an idea about it, but to understand the neuroscience behind it, the same way we are with romantic relationships. So we're in the process of looking at how do we develop a behavioral coding system that could be adjusted from the one that is tied to romantic relationships, which is the specific affect coding system that Gottman developed. So a colleague of ours, Paul Peluso, down at Florida Atlantic University, started the process by looking at just you as an adult interacting with a therapist and him predicting success or failure. Working with Gottman to come up with the SPAF coding system to look at videos of the therapeutic interaction during a counseling session. And he is now able to find a way to predict whether your counseling as an adult is going to be successful or not using all the physiological response sets, using the SPAF coding system, the EEG analysis, and we can now say, hey, you know, it's not just this touchy-feely thing of is therapy going to be okay, but the fact is that we can predict it using the same differential equation models that Gottman developed. So the whole thing now is prediction and replication. Can we continue to demonstrate over and over again that we find the same results given numbers and numbers of studies? And so far, in terms of success or failure of your relationships, it holds water that we can show whether your relationship is going to succeed or fail. There's a book called Blink by Malcolm Gladwell. If you haven't read it, pick it up. It talks a lot about Gottman's research and how he can just look at some couple for 10 minutes. And the fact is that it's called trained intuition, that he's done this so many times, he's looked at so many couples that he can now say without even doing the coding system, I see all of those things, and I know without really thinking about it that your relationship is going to succeed or fail. And the chances are that he's 90 to 95% accurate because of all the training he's gone through. It's just part of his normal process. So I was on the phone today. I was in a room observing a interaction. It was an evaluation process, and we had a subject that was doing some computer interaction, and we had a user interface test expert that was working with that subject. And so I was observing, and we didn't know anything about the subject, but I was listening to the subject and I'm saying to myself, well, her speech is pressured. It's at an increased rate. And I'm going through this in my head. She's jumping around the page a lot. And there were more and more elements that popped up. And finally, I said to myself, this woman has bipolar disorder. And it was about 10 minutes into the observation. I didn't see the woman. I heard her talking. I watched her interaction just on a computer screen with a mouse. And I was seeing her use of the computer screen. At the end of the interaction, she talked about how her problems led her back out in the street, and she had lived on the street for a couple of years, and that she had always thought she was defective, and guess what? She had bipolar disorder. The fact is that we go through this research stuff so much, we code these behaviors so often, that we can see these things without having the coding system in it. So I'm telling you that because it's easy to just say this is, you know, kind of fluffy stuff to talk about, you know, do you show intimacy with your partner? Do you listen? Do you show empathy? Are you reciprocal? we can predict these things out in science, and we can show you in video, and then we can do it over time and demonstrate to you that this stuff is true. So if you see the four horsemen of the apocalypse in your relationship, it's not too late. You can do something about it. You can start to work toward creating those signs of a successful relationship and demonstrating and practicing a healthy interaction style. It's up to you whether you decide if you have the commitment to each other to do that or not. So any of you have any questions about what I've talked about in terms of healthy interactions, about relationships, about the four horsemen of the apocalypse? Anybody have a nail in the forehead? Go ahead, toward the back row here. This is a great question. What I heard was, so you're talking about the four horsemen of the apocalypse, and what you notice is that there's some criticism in the relationship, and mostly I'm guessing on the side of the partner. How do you bring that up to your partner without it causing a fight? Right? So one of the things that most of us do, when we get a little nugget of information like this, we bring it up in the middle of a fight. Right? Oh yeah? Well, I went to a workshop last week and let me tell you what I heard. And this is what you're doing, right? And that, of course, is not going to work. So thinking about, you know, having a time to actually have a relationship talk that is healthy. Not it's time for us to have a talk and, you know, lay things on the line and decide where this is going. But really, if there's a commitment with each other to say, hey, I figured out some things that I think could help us do better as a couple. And I think it'll be healthy for you to figure out for you what are some things you can do as well, so it's not just about your partner. So, you know, there's some things that I could see that I'm identifying from a talk I went to that could help us really be a better couple. And so one of the things might be that, you know, when I'm interacting with you, that I put my phone down and I listen. One of the things that I heard was that there's some ways that criticism can really impact a relationship negatively. And this is what it looks like, and this is what I hear you saying sometimes. And I'm wondering if there's ways we can get around that, if we could do it differently. And can we work together to make that happen? If it's all about the other person, you say, you need to do it differently, that probably is going to set up a defensiveness. But if there's a way you can work together to battle the problem and make the problem external to the person, so criticism has come a part of our relationship. How can we work together to eliminate that? And I think that's an important way to put it, because otherwise you're putting the person on the defensive instead of joining with them and saying, let's look at criticism as something that's come in to impact us negatively. Let's figure out how to fix it. Does that make sense? I have a question in the back.
Swear. Yeah.
So you talked about essentially the positive from this one of the parts of letting go of the ideal.
Yes.
What are just a few steps of how to let go of the ideal?
So how do we let go of the ideal of a relationship? Part of the problem is that the media has kind of created this model through movies, through TV, of what a relationship should be. And we look at our relationship and we see the flaws in it, and we think about, oh my God, this is not what a relationship is supposed to be. And so what I think the biggest steps are is individually to take a realistic appraisal of your relationship and recognize that every relationship has positive and negatives, and to recognize, to see if there's the positives outweigh the negatives, right? That's the biggest piece. Do our positives in our relationship outweigh the negative? You always look at, is the grass greener on the other side? Does this other couple that looks so happy, they probably have a perfect life, and the truth is you're just not seeing their interactions. And so it's about changing the lens with which you view the world and recognizing that other people have just as many problems as you. That every couple, even the couples that are successful that we interviewed, have had struggles. They've had fights. They've had arguments. They've had things that have gone on for a while, things that have threatened their relationship. The thing that's different is those threats to the relationship, they've come toward each other and turned together to help it grow stronger in the end. So letting go of it is, I think, having some conversations with people about the reality of their relationships, hearing from other people that have had successful relationships and what's been successful and what have been the struggles they've had to find out that it's not perfect. You know, it's asking those questions and talking about it, but recognizing in reality sense that we don't live in a TV or movie world, that everybody struggles. Okay. In order to foster an intimate relationship, what's kind of the pathway to being honest and open about your past, to really let the person in, let them know, especially if it's not flattering, if there's some things you've done that you're not proud of, and letting a person in? I say the first date. I'm kidding. You know, that's one of the things. I gave some advice on this to, I'm trying to remember who it was. I think it was Prevention Magazine. They asked me about first dates. That was one of the things I said. On the first date or in the early stages of the relationship, you're getting to know each other and you're building a trust. And so that trust, you're not hiding things or lying, but you don't want to jump right in and just throw everything out there because you're going to scare a partner away, right? It's about mutually getting to that place where both of you are comfortable having that conversation. Recognizing that your partner has a past too. The other important thing is that it's really true that you cannot unring a bell. You have to decide very carefully what are the details of what you're sharing and how important are they to the relationship. You know, if you've had multiple partners, okay, that's important to share. The details of what happened in those intimate other partner relationships, not so important to share. You can't undo that once you've shared those things, right? And so thinking about carefully what information each other needs to know, talking about it openly, and making that determination and having good, honest conversations about the conversation itself. So asking, you know, there's stuff I want to talk about with you. You know, maybe we should talk about when that's okay. And when do we get to that place? And that conversation, even bringing that up, is not the first date. It's somewhere along the line as you're developing trust for each other and saying, hey, we're getting to know each other pretty better, you know, a lot better. We're developing a relationship. You know, there's parts that I want to share, but I want to know it's the right time to do that. Let's talk about when that is. And it's not right then. You know, so it's just about preparing for the conversation, not springing it on the person, actually planning for it. And having an open discussion. But again, I'm going to say this, and I can't say it enough. There are bells that cannot be unrung. Don't share every intimate detail. Go ahead. And I'll get you next. So I'm going to take one more question after this, and then we'll wrap up because I want to be respectful of your time. I notice a lot of people are leaving. But the question is, what do you do if you notice that your relationship is moving more to toward a friend basis and kind of the intimacy is going away, and how do you kind of deal with that? I actually did an interview with Bustle.com. It's a women's website, one of the largest women's websites in the world, exactly on that issue last month. And, you know, how do you know if your partner's losing interest, if it's a friendship issue, and it's moving away? You know, the thing that happens with those is that we typically do recognize it. We recognize that people are coming up with excuses for not spending time with us, that the intimacy is happening less and less, the sexual relationship is fading. And that's one of those things where we're not wanting to own it and acknowledge it. And so the important part is to have an honest conversation about it and say, hey, you know, we are seeming to not have as much sex. We're not having that intimacy. Is this moving toward friendship? And let's be honest and have an adult conversation about it. If the person can't have an adult conversation about it with you, that's a sign too. And it's important to be able to, you know, if you're able to start a romantic and intimate relationship, you should be able to talk about it. That's part of being an adult and being mature. So it's important to be able to have that conversation and to have those expectations of your partner. And you had a question?
Does all this research hold true to long distance relationships? Have there been any studies done specifically on that long distance aspect?
Does it hold true for long distance relationships? The research has been done on all kinds of configurations of relationships, homosexual relationships, heterosexual relationships, long distance relationships. And there's some different patterns that emerge in terms of the interaction styles, but the same four horsemen of the apocalypse, the same predictors of success in terms of turning toward each other to resolve problems of intimacy, are all predictors of relationship success or failure. Because you're in a long distance relationship, that doesn't mean it's problematic. People thrive successfully in long distance relationships, and those could be very long term. It's a matter of how, when you are together, do you demonstrate intimacy? How in your phone calls do you demonstrate intimacy? Do you use technology in a way that helps to facilitate your relationship? You know, so it's those things. You know, if I'm in a long distance relationship and I want to isolate and I just don't respond to texts and I, you know, cut off the phone or I don't answer when it rings, you know, that's the turning away and stonewalling and doing all those kind of things. So we could identify those behaviors in a long-term long distance relationship the same way we can if someone's interacting in the same room. All right, well, thank you all very much. I appreciate you listening. I loved all your questions. Thank you.